Thank you very much. Thank you, thank you. It's nice to see so many enthusiastic faces here. I hope you're not too depressed by the whole exhausting application process. I just remembered, 6 years ago, seven years from now, in summer 2009, I was applying for, 20, 30 universities. Sorry? Well, also, Iron is also a cool name, actually. Okay. When I was applying for universities, I felt kind of uncomfortable, thank you very much, to have all of this paperwork lying around in my room. The whole room was covered in papers. It wasn't that much fun. And I thought, this is really one of the biggest challenges in my life, to just apply to university. And in the third semester of my psychology studies in Mannheim, I actually noticed that for me, it was already a big challenge. But how is it actually for people that come from a country that they had to leave because there's a crisis area, there might be a war, they might be politically persecuted in their country, and they don't have a passport anymore, and you simply need to hand in a passport. They might not have a legal status anymore simply because they are labeled as refugees. And in Germany, there's 50 different titles that you can have. You can be a citizen, you can be a refugee due to the UNHCR definition, you can be temporary, okay, kind of. So there's 50 different statuses, just three of which allow you to actually apply to university. And there's more problems that people have to face that come to our country. So what we basically did is, why we built this up was because there are so many people out there that are coming to Germany, to France, to other countries, and all they want to do is to really start a new life and just continue what they were doing before. It's actually not that hard and pretty understandable. And I learned this especially in a psychological counseling where I met people like Sajida that were not telling me or not complaining about the food that they got or living with 25 people in one small room. That was not the biggest problem for them. The number one question when I asked them, what do I actually really have to do to help you, was create a perspective for us. Do something that's just fun, maybe. Bring some food, bring some music, let's have a party here. That's way more important than talking about our traumatic experiences that we had. That you can do once we have a perspective and we really know what we are actually doing, this whole walks to the institutions, to the Bürgerämter, and so on. So the situation that we have is exactly the four barriers that I already mentioned. It's the high school certification to enter university, language proficiency, the legal status, documents, and also, of course, the college capacity, so high competition that our higher education sector has when it comes to access to higher education. Also, costs are mostly associated when you think about private universities. It's the legal situation, it's the capacity, it's the language. What do we do to solve this issue? So after my first semester, or my first three semesters in Mannheim, I met a good friend of mine again who had this idea to build up a new kind of nano university, that's what he called it, or he also called it cuddling university, which should work in a way for students to have a sneak preview into their future study subjects. So for people to really make an informed decision about what you actually feel passionate about, that's also what you should study. And math and engineering might be completely something different than what you learned in school. So this was his original idea. And since I was working with refugees at this time in psychological counseling in Berlin, I thought it would be great to just apply this idea, especially for refugees, which we did by, on the one hand side, just bundling these courses, so you can kind of imagine it like Google, the internet suddenly comes up, there's many websites, people are confused, and someone has to navigate through them. That's the one thing that we do. We bundle these online courses into study programs. The second thing is that we also make partnerships with universities that recognize these courses. So our students start studying for the first 1 or 2 years, and then we transfer them to partner universities where seats have already become free due to the dropout rates. We also pimp these courses with the latest e-learning technology. So there are some mechanisms how to support students, like direct academics courses, where our students have an additional session to ask all of the questions that they want, and many more systems. And of course, since it's a global challenge that we are facing, it also has to be a global solution. Let's say someone gets a permission to stay in Germany for 3 years, but then this person might have to go back to his home country. Of course, it's ideal if you can just take your university with you on a smartphone, in your laptop, and maybe continue studying somewhere else. So that's how the path of our students looks like from the student perspective. We currently offer 4 big faculties. There's several study programs within these faculties again. And we simply did this by asking our students, what do you actually want to study? We didn't ask the labor market, or we really just built the things that our users think are needed. So, as I said, the one thing we are doing is to build up this new kind of platform to collect open educational resources in an academic, professional way. The second thing, and that's, I think, the most important thing, in my opinion, is offline services that make online programs valuable. There's always this very scary picture of a student just sitting in front of his computer, studying all day long, and kind of starting to behave weird. That's not what we want to do. We actually believe that online courses are a great resource to transfer knowledge to students, but the real acquisition of knowledge, just like in a beginner's week in Leuphana or also the Leuphana semester itself, it's about really applying that knowledge, learning by experience. And we created different formats to achieve this, like direct academics courses, where we turn MOOCs, massive open online courses, into spooks, into small private online courses, so that our students also have face-to-face in their interactions with their fellow students, and there is an academic advisor that they can just ask all of their questions. Of course, there's study hubs, just places where people can meet. We equip those with computers, with internet access. The Welcome Learning Center here in Lüneburg actually also functions as a study hub, if you want to have a look at it. It's a really nice place. And our people can study there, but most often they also begin to start their own projects. So after a while, we figured that 50% of our students nearly already have a degree. So for them, it's not so much about getting a degree in Germany. It's actually more about the network, the feeling to suddenly have a passion, a task in life again, and also what many students told us, the self-identity change that they experience. They suddenly don't feel as refugees anymore. They feel like they are students. And that's a huge difference when it comes to your personal motivation to get up in the morning. And then, of course, everything else that universities should provide, like career opportunities, internships, language courses, especially important for our students, counseling services, buddy programs, everything with the goal to really enhance the student experience and just create a normal campus life like we all know it. So at the moment, where are we currently at? We started Chiron in March 2015, and I was also asked to tell you some personal stories, so I would like to give you a sneak preview into the world of social startups in Berlin and how difficult it can be to actually do such a thing. We started in March 2015 to found the company, so we already thought about the idea about half a year before, and once we had the concept ready and we did the first prototype testings, which was actually a lot of fun. I, for example, went to my old university in Mannheim, where I got a course in surfing, surf course in California, recognized as organizational psychology. And then I found this course on edX from Harvard University in organizational psychology. And I simply asked my study coordinator if he could also recognize the organizational psychology course from Harvard instead of my surf course. And he was kind of had a big question mark in his face because he didn't know how to handle the situation, which is always a good sign in Germany when someone can't tell you that you're not allowed to do it. There's probably a way to do it then. So this was kind of the beginnings of the whole project. But of course, after a while, it comes to the point where there's 10, 15 volunteers working on such a project for a year, and your savings are kind of going to an end, so you also need funding. And we did a big campaign where we asked many foundations, ministries, prizes that we applied for, and we won exactly zero of them. There was no one who believed in this idea. For small foundations, it was too big. For the big ones, they didn't have really the trust in us. So we decided to do a crowdfunding campaign. And that's also something that I would really like to engage you guys to. I also was a coach last year for some projects here, and two of the projects that actually came out really developed a crowdfunding campaign within the first week and raised several thousand euros to really try out their projects. So I think crowdfunding is a great mechanism of getting a first approval from the community if your idea is really that good or maybe not that good, and also to get an additional funding. Okay, we raised about 600,000 euros in this campaign then, and were able to enroll the first 1,000 students, and now the second official year has started, even though there are no semester times within our organization, but the next 3,000 students just started to study now. 1,500 are currently active on the platform, so some of them are still in the application process also. That's some numbers of the countries our students come from, their ages. You can also see that there's actually some people that are already a little older, and it really goes back sometimes even to people who have a PhD, but they just don't get it recognized in Germany. So some PhD holders are within our group of students. Okay, so what does our team look like? That's a picture from our last Chiron Global Weekend. We do this every 3 months that we invite the whole team for a little retreat. This time we've been to a nice lake, and there were around, I think, 60 employees and 100 volunteers at this weekend. So, as you can see, it's also a lot of fun to work in such a team, but also just to volunteer in such a project. So the network that we built up is really based on an international scale, because the courses that we mostly take advantage of are produced in the United States. 90% of them are from universities like MIT, Harvard, Stanford, Yale. That's the ones that are really strong in producing MOOCs, and it also shows that the education you can actually get there is really the world's best education. It's professors that whose ego is so big that they think they have to share their knowledge with the world, and that's the reason for them to actually build up these courses. And of course, there's many people who can potentially benefit with it if you put it in the right ecosystem. We are currently active in 4 countries. We pretty much cover Germany now, so there's a lot of university partnerships just starting in Turkey, in Lebanon, Jordan, and also in France, where we got the Sios Po, for example, now as a partner. So these slides are basically just to show how great we are. Our vision. What I would like to talk a little bit is the vision that we have, especially when it comes to diversity. One of the main reasons for us to start such a project and not just wait for politics to solve everything was the fact that politics might be asking the wrong questions. So emergent out of a diversity perspective, and I would like to ask you that, what do you think is the right question? How much should the German universities do to give refugees access to higher education? Should they open their doors? Should they not open their doors? Under which conditions should they open their doors? And that's all of the questions that are discussed within the political system. But no one actually comes to the idea to ask the question, we want to help you, so what do you actually need? And that's a question that's very rarely seen in politics, also in other decision environments, to really take your focus group in the center of the whole discussion and actually ask the people, what do they need? Because they are the ones who have the diverse backgrounds. They are the ones who are in a situation where they might still struggle with a completely new culture that they just arrived in, with two children at home that they have to take care of because their husband might have been left behind, and living in a refugee camp with 10 other people 20 kilometers outside of Lüneburg. That's definitely not a situation where you can stick to a fixed schedule, just start right away studying in a new language, and also keep up with the pace of students like most of us probably are, not really having that much more to do than university. So the question of diversity for me is much more than just putting a colorful team together. For me, it's an essential part in the development of every project that you discuss this kind of project on an eye-to-eye level with your customer base, and actually also involve them in the whole process of setting up a solution. And this is what I would really like to engage you also for the week or for your project starting tomorrow. If you have a good idea, if you think you found a clever solution for a social problem that you identified, go out and test it. Go out and don't just ask people if they like it, also ask them for better ideas. Ask them to try it out, to really see how they interact with it, and always involve other people as much as possible in the whole product development process. Because this, in the end, doesn't just mean that you thought about diversity. Diversity will actually be naturally integrated in all of the solutions that you come up with. And if you did it right, you actually can't fail. You will already know that it works out. So do we with Kyron, and I hope, I'm happy to hear some of your questions. Thank you.
Hello, thank you for your presentation. Could you briefly say something about the decision making in your organization? Like, are there hierarchies or?
Not possible quickly.
Okay.
So diversity is also a topic for us that we implemented in the whole setup of the organization. It's a process that's called holacracy, which is basically based on the book Reinventing Organizations. It's a principle where you don't think in organizational structure, but instead you think in processes. So a process for us is to, the really big thing, make the best possible study program that refugees can successfully study. In order to do this, we have to fulfill certain assumptions. And every assumption, like for online courses to study, you need probably a space to study, a computer and internet access. For every assumption, there is a purpose that we define. And this purpose makes up a circle. So we don't have departments, we just have circles that fulfill purposes. And once every purpose is fulfilled, the whole concept should actually work. And this leads to a structure where you don't necessarily have any hierarchies, but instead it's teams of at least four people that make up these circles and discuss as long as there's no objection anymore. So there is never a democratic vote. There's never a yes to something, but everything that is proposed is done. So you have an idea, you are doing an internship, you just do it. Except there is an objection of someone. For example, a few weeks ago we had the discussion of doing a women empowerment program to especially recruit female students. And I was completely against it, not because I don't like women, because I think we already reached out to women pretty much, and it's just 80-20 from the people that are coming to us at the moment. So we couldn't not reach more women, and would have wasted our resources, in my opinion. So this was an objection. The team couldn't do it. In the end, they raised additional funds in their free time, applied at a foundation. We had 1.5 people that we could additionally hire, and those are now doing exactly this kind of program. So that's how you solve issues and how you make decisions in this structure. But it's another 1-hour talk to really explain the whole picture, so I will leave it with that.
You should use the microphone.
Okay,
that way.
Maybe. My question was, you just slided over the slide where you said your 4 pillows and the solutions you got. Maybe you can show that. I would really like to see that.
It's actually the test for our new presentation today, so
okay.
I didn't know too well what's on it. This one?
That one, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So it's basically the cost problem. An online solution is scalable. Our costs are around 5 to 10% of the costs that a normal university has. Language, of course, with online courses. All of the courses are in English, which is already easier for most people, but there's also the chance to subtitle them in around 40 different languages, so that's also more flexible. Legal, there's just no legal status online. You can basically sign up with your Facebook account, and the capacity problem is also not existent online. That's basically the problems and how we solve them. The whole concept is the platform itself, kind of the navigation function, and the additional services that the ecosystem that we put this platform into.
Hi, I've got a question too. How do you finance yourself besides fundraising?
Oh yeah, good question. I didn't even say that. So we started out with private donations. Crowdfunding was the first thing we did. There were some private investors coming in, some foundations. Mostly right now it's project-based, so after a while there's ministries approaching you, asking you if you can do some work for them in order to fulfill their goals mostly. So projects are not always fun, but it's always good money. And this, for example, means for us that we go with the Ministry for International Development and Cooperation to Jordan and do the same thing there. We went to Turkey with the Google Foundation. We are doing the biggest project in Germany now with the Education Ministry. So that's how we currently fund ourselves. And the status that we are in after 1.5 years now is pretty much directly before the proof of concept, how you call it in the startup world. So to really have shown that your product actually works, it's quite easy when you produce a soft drink, because if the soft drink tastes well, you succeeded. When you create an educational platform, it takes 3 or 4 years until our first students also graduate, which would be the proof of concept for us. So that's what we really focus on at the moment. And once we have done this, there is sustainable financing models. You can, for example, set up a social return on investment analysis, which is something that's very popular in the US. You basically calculate how much of the work that the state should do, like education, have I taken over with my organization and what we are doing. And then the state might either fund it. There's systems like social impact bonds where companies create a fund together and give you kind of a small amount of the money in terms of impact back to your organization. And then, of course, there's the traditional ways that private universities fund themselves. Things like generation contracts where students don't have to pay tuition fees in the moment when they study, but once they earn more than 50,000 euro in a year, they pay them back, or the companies pay it back, which would be more elegant. So that's the ideas we are spinning around, but mostly at the moment it's donations and projects.
Hello, I'm all the way up here. Maybe you can see me. The question, I wanted to say that I really like this project, and I wanted to encourage all the new students, to become a part of the Buddy program. But besides that, I wanted to know, you knowing the kind of obstacles that the new students or the refugees face in order to become part of such a university, do you think actually that this is unfair and in a way institutional discrimination? Do you think there are differences and it's okay for them to get a preparation course or anything like that in order to become part of this normal university lifestyle? Or do you feel like it's discrimination in a way?
You mean the state institutions?
Yeah.
Yes and no. I think it's understandable. It's a situation that I can understand. Political institutions just take a longer time to adapt to new situations. Also universities definitely need some time to adapt. So for us, also this was not really the reason why we started Chiron. It was really the reason that we also saw in the long run it might just take a different institution than the conventional university, especially when it comes to accessing higher education. So for your question, I think it's, yes, the status quo is or was kind of discriminating, but that's just how it always is when things change so rapidly. It needs 4 or 5 years until the established institutions have adapted. But that's the opportunities of civil society, right? I mean, the whole refugee situation just created such a big space for also innovation that I think such a concept, we probably could not have executed it without the whole refugee challenge. That was one of the main reasons why universities started to talk with us, why they were thinking about alternative ways to give access to refugees for higher education. They wanted to do something themselves. It's definitely not their own motivation, but they are just bound to legal restrictions that we as a startup do not necessarily have in this way.
So you said that students can start studying regardless of their legal status. Other side, over here. is that ever a problem for them later on? There must be a reason that usually there are certain requirements for students to start studying. Is that later when they're looking for a job, are they still seen the same way, even though they didn't have to provide those requirements to start out with?
It's mostly a time problem, actually. So for most people, it also just simply takes 2 or 3 years. The best example is just the language proficiency. To get to a C1 level will take you 2 years. There's no way around it. So you could prevent it for the legal documentation, for the status issues, but still those might take maybe a year at least. And if you all put it in place and you look at the whole chain, what's happening when you come to Germany, it's not that everything happens at once, but first you have to actually get your first interviews, which takes up to a year, to 1 or 2 years sometimes. Once they approved your status, that's actually the moment when you get language courses. So before, you have to organize them by yourself, which is mostly not possible. So in the end, it's always these 3-4 years that people are struggling in the beginning. And especially for this time, we created an alternative way to just start right away. And I've seen what happens with people, even if they just stay in the camps for 2 years without having anything to do, and people change.
You're a very young company. It's your second year, and my question is, how is your plan for the future? I mean, your applications rised a lot from the first to the second year. In the first year, you could take 1,000. In the second year, you could take 3,000. So you have 4,000 in total. And it seems like it's very... people like the idea, what you are doing, and there can be a big potential in something very big, something really cool. I like your idea and your company. And what is your plan for the future? Do you have a solid 5-year plan? Can you tell us something about what you actually plan in rising, improving and getting better in the future?
Yeah, sure. So our main focus for the next 1.5 years is to get the proof of concept, which means we will not get into crazy numbers, but instead take on students every time we have a certain question that we want to observe. So at the moment, we are looking at questions like, is our application process, which is simply no application process, a good one? which is an interesting question, because what does the Abiturnote necessarily say about you becoming a good psychologist? It might actually be better to just take the first 1 or 2 courses within the study programs and kind of take this as a predicting variable for your study success later on. So these questions, what support services do we need to offer to our students? That's all in development, and we are running pilots on this with a certain number of students to really see scientifically how big are actually the effects when it comes to feeling powerful again, having the control over your life, feeling self-efficacy. So that's currently our questions, and those will go on until 2018. And once we know that in terms of these things that are really important to us, and also simply numbers, retention rates, students really coming through, students getting jobs, if those numbers are good, we would open up the platform internationally, and that's what we already prepare for. So we talk a lot with international universities that might later on in India and Pakistan also be interested to adopt this concept. But we wouldn't necessarily do it ourselves. So for us, the goal is not to be an internal institution. We would actually like very much to not be necessary anymore, and just put the platform open source, like Wikipedia, so everyone could use it, everyone can place their online courses there, it's completely for free, and then people just get kind of a handbook on how to set up support structures, so people can also study in this new kind of way. And then everyone can apply it for whatever you want. Doesn't necessarily need to be refugees, could also be people that are 200 kilometers away from the next university.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Markus, for your time, for your great presentation here. I think you have a great project going on there. Thank especially, you. I think it's very important for, like you said, when these guys come to Germany, when they are stuck in the camps for 1 year, 2 year, to the whole process gets sorted out, to have something to do, you know, just not be sitting around, but to have a goal you can achieve. And therefore, I think it's a really great project. Wish you best luck.
Thank you very much.
So we appreciate your time here. Give him a big hand, please.